Well, hello everyone. This is Ganeva Grebna and Patrick Hans, and we are talking about Formula One and data-driven aspects of Formula One. And today we're discussing 1951. Hi, Patrick. How are you today?
Hey, Gunnar, thanks. I'm doing fine. Good to be back.
Yeah, it's great to be back. And yeah, so today we are going to talk about 1951 season, which is kind of the second official season of the championship and the fifth season overall, right? So it's like we said before, it started earlier than 1950, but we are only going to keep track of seasons from 1950. So that was the next year after 1950.
Yes, and I think it was a very interesting season.
Yeah. So, yeah, shall we go to the overview of the season?
Yeah, I mean, first we have one general slide. I mean,
Oh,
as we are the data-driven Formula One YouTube channel, podcast, whatever, I think it is a good question to ask a little bit what is our focus because. I have here the what we know as the DIKW pyramids, which includes data as a base, but based on data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. I mean, despite the name data-driven, I mean data-driven here is the base. We are not here in this YouTube channel, of course, explaining the data. This would be a little bit boring, but we are discussing it, so which means we include information and also we connect them. Sometimes we connect them, for example, the 51 season to today, to aspects of behavioral science, whatever. And so we create knowledge and maybe in some moments or even wisdom.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't know what is your point here, as let's say you are a data scientist.
Yeah, I guess yeah, we need to probably explain to our listeners again. So if you just tuned in and you haven't seen the previous episodes, yeah, I'm a professor of business analytics and data science, and I wrote several papers on Formula One from again from the data-driven standpoint. So that's kind of quite computational papers, looking at leadership and looking at performance of teams. And Patrick wrote several books on the topic. Yeah, I think the main focus of the channel is not only to look at data, but also at insight, right? Because you can have the best data, and we will see that in later seasons, that you can have the best data and you can have a lot of data, but what you do with it is important. And sometimes the over-availability of data could be a disadvantage rather than advantage. And I guess these are the things that we're discussing during our interventions each week. And today, I guess that the approach that we decided to take is we decided to start from 1950 season and look at different stages of data and analytics and knowledge and insight that we have from the data, and how these things developed throughout the history of Formula One. Because originally, as we discussed last time, and I think this is also true for 1951 season, the driver was the main sensor, right, within the car. And yeah, all information that you had mostly was generated through the driver, and driver was actually transmitting this information to the rest of the team, and trying to achieve some advance in mechanical engineering and in strategy as well. So yeah, and we will see how that changes throughout the history, because currently this is a big team of multiple analysts. Many people are working on the car, and yeah, so we are just, I guess, fascinated by this, well, I personally am fascinated by this journey of the sport. And yeah, that's what we're looking at in these videos.
And exactly, and as you also shortly mentioned last time, the driver was not only the sensor, but also sometimes the algorithm. We had later we had drivers like Lauda, who was called the computer. We had Prost, who was called the professor. So it's not that with all the sensors, the information are going directly to the management in the pits, but also the driver is still a relevant decision maker, even if we have now information in the cloud, we have the telemetry technology and all this stuff.
Yeah, and so back in the day, a lot was done on intuition, and this is what we're going to see in earlier seasons a lot. So yeah, sometimes you wouldn't know what the right thing is from analytics or from data that you would get, but you could sense it, and these intuitive decisions were quite important. Actually, you know, using the example of 1951 season, we actually will see how, you know, the strategy changes and how sometimes wrong strategy fires back.
So exactly, and you're right. We've seen some examples, examples for human predictions as drivers changed cars with their colleagues, as the team thought this would be the driver most likely to win the championship, for example.
Right. So yeah, we need to also remind our viewers that 1951 season still awarded first five places with points, right? And points went in kind of 2 point differences. So it was 8 points for the first place, 6, then 4, then 2. And then we also had 1 point that was awarded for the fastest lap. So that's basically the structure of the point system. We kind of try to remind you about this because the point system changed throughout the history of Formula One. So it's important to understand how you would aggregate points in the championship.
Yeah, that's correct. And with this, we are coming, let's say, directly to the season. Mm-hmm. We have already 8 official races. The same as already valid in the 1950 season, we had a high number of non-official races, so invitation races. The results not included into the championship, but nevertheless, they have been quite important for the teams to earn money, of course, also for the drivers, as based on the contracts, maybe similar to a sales employee today, they have been paid on success fee, so they may get 50% of the prize money or 20%. However, each driver somehow negotiated individually their contracts.
Yeah, I mean, we will definitely talk about how you make money in Formula One. I think for now, so you need to understand that the most important part is to participate in the next race. So that's the most important thing, not to drop out in the middle of the season. And the most durable kind of, the most durable teams in terms of, you know, that they still can continue to the next race are normally the big money makers. Yeah, we will definitely discuss how the budgets are distributed. And another important thing to understand about Formula One is that Formula One is, if you look at kind of economic terminology of it, or game theory terminology, is like imperfectly discriminating contest, what we call in economics. Basically, it means that you can exert the highest effort but still lose. And we will see that in terms of budgets as well, because there were teams with very high budgets and they didn't actually manage to achieve good results. So we will definitely discuss that in later seasons. Yeah, so this season is, I think, very interesting. And to me, I think the major highlight of the season, and I will talk about it at the end of the episode as well, to me, this is kind of the season when Ferrari actually finally stood out as a as one of the leaders of the championship, even though they didn't win this championship. If you can see the table on your screen right now, you would understand that Alfa Romeo was the winning team. However, as you can see on the screen, we have three Ferrari wins, and that's Silverstone, Nürburgring, and Monza. And this was extremely important season because it kind of showcased the end of the line of Alphas, and kind of we were slowly going into this Ferrari domination. Yes, I think like to me this is one of the highlights. What do you think, Patrick? Is that
I agree, especially as Ferrari as a team, and maybe we do this talk about it in some other episode. I mean, it's as an Italian team in opposite to the British team, it was also very many emotions included, as we will discuss later when we speak about the British Grand Prix. And of course, it was the beginning of Ferrari as the today's most successful Formula One team. So we had before the Swiss Grand Prix, we already had a number of non-official races, and here already we had various victories by the Ferrari team. Important also to know, in 1951, it was Formula One was not that regulated as today, so we not had practically a limitation on two cars and two drivers. But especially in later races, later in the season, the teams invited a third or fourth drivers, or just had one additional driver in one race. And also, it wasn't that drivers had been that specialized as today. So all the Formula One drivers, they not only drove these monoposto cars, but they also drove a lot of them in
Le Mans,
in sports cars like Le Mans, street cars like the Mille Miglia, or any other kind of races. So they've been quite universal in opposite today.
Yeah, and in terms of, yeah, we will talk about engineering in a second, but yeah, I think the major change in terms of engineering was the fact that, you know, Alfa Romeos were 1.5 liter cars, and Ferraris were 4.5 liter cars, so they were a lot more fuel efficient. You know, this season actually started to show this heterogeneity in engineering, where we, you know, we couldn't quite differentiate in the previous season. When we looked at cars, we saw that they kind of all try to look a little bit like Alphas, a little bit the same. Yeah. We will look shortly at different car makes, and you will see the difference in when you just look at cars, they would look different. And the reason for that is that we started to see differentiation.
Exactly. And I mean, if we go directly to the first race, Switzerland, honestly, I don't remember when we had the last Grand Prix in Switzerland. It must be decades ago, but now 51 and also in 1950, we had a Grand Prix in Switzerland. And I mean, this still began as you would have expected it. We had the young driver. He wasn't that young at this moment, but related to Farina, he was like 10 years younger. Mm-hmm. So he did the fastest lap, Juan Manuel Fangio. He did the pole position, and also he won this Grand Prix. So it was the start of the season, as you may have predicted it, just based on the 1950 season. The Alfa Romeos had been dominating.
Yeah, I think another few important things about Swiss Grand Prix, and again, maybe this is something that was a highlight. Like to me, this was probably Swiss Grand Prix and Silverstone were two highlights of the season in terms of Grand Prix, because Swiss Grand Prix had also differentiation in strategy. So during the Swiss Grand Prix, I mean, normally we would expect that in Spa we have rain, but that year in Switzerland it was raining, and not only was it raining, but there were trees on the course, so it was extremely dangerous. And and here we actually saw the differentiation in character of two drivers, Juan Manuel Fangio and Nino Farina, who both started for Alfa Romeo that season. And Fangio, as you know, we talked about him last time, and he made a decision not to change the tires. And that was an extremely bad decision, because, you know, it made the car really inefficient for him. Whereas Fangio, he drove perfectly and his strategy was right on target. So he actually made all the right decisions, and he took into account the weather. And this was what differentiated him from his teammate, you know, not to mention other drivers, and allowed him to win. So yeah, so that was kind of not only it's like Patrick, like you were saying, it was not we haven't had a race in Switzerland for a long time, probably for a good reason, because it's not very very safe probably now to race in Switzerland. But it was a very interesting race that year.
Yes, and I mean, this point perfectly also shows the difference to from 1951 to today. Today we have each team has a weather expert connected to the database. Maybe they even have local weather experts, but in that race, we had the driver directly thinking, could it rain, could it not rain? So the driver still had a higher grade in the decision making.
Yeah, exactly. So the weather forecast, you know, currently, like, we have a whole team thinking through the weather, you know, yeah. We have very detailed prediction for the weather for the race, but at the time it didn't exist. I mean, you had weather forecast in some, you know, in some form before the race, so you knew it might rain, but you didn't know what time of the day, what minute of the hour, you know. Exactly. So yeah, so whereas currently, like, you have much more precise information about that.
Yeah. With this, we are going overseas. Also in 1951, we had the Indianapolis 500 inside the agenda, but to be honest, it was just on the paper, as there had been no European participating here.
Yeah, and you could see from the schedule it was impossible, right? Because it's just 3 days after the Swiss Grand Prix, you had the American one, yes.
Yeah, so it was impossible, but also, I mean, there wasn't, let's say, a bigger wish of the European teams to travel there. We are still in 1951, so quite short after Second World War, so the budget have been quite limited, and we may mention this also later today, as it has influenced the later 52 season.
Yeah, exactly. So that's kind of the season in a nutshell, as you can see. And yeah, we have Fangio won this season, as you could see, and Alfa Romeo won the championship that year. And we will see in a second why.
Exactly. I mean, you see, then we had the classic Grand Prix like Spa-Francorchamps, and which is one of the fastest races traditionally. I had the pleasure to drive at Spa, because at least some years ago it was part of the normal Belgian public street, so you can drive there with your car, and it's even if you drive normally with a personal car, it's quite impressive going up the hills into the curves. And you, so you may imagine a Formula One on these streets.
Like we said before, the another cool thing about Spa is like normally trains. So, and if
yes.
If you are not Formula One kind of savvy, you probably you need to understand that, you know, when you have a superior car and inferior car in good weather, you practically have no chance in inferior car. So if Patrick is in superior car and I'm in inferior car, if the weather is great, then, you know, there's no way I can do anything about it. But if it rains, everything slows down. So even the superior cars will slow down. So then, you know, in the rain, better drivers have actually a chance to show their, you know, their skill. And so that's why Spa is always, to me, a very interesting race. And so very often it has some sort of intrigue with the weather. And in Silverstone it's kind of like that as well, but, you know, it's... we often have rain there, but very often they try to hold this race in the summer where, you know, you often also have nice weather. So, but yeah, Spa is a race that where we normally have some interesting weather, rain or wet weather.
And with this, we come slowly to the fourth race in France. The results had been quite as predicted. We have again Fangio pole position, fastest lap, and also the winning driver. As we shortly mentioned here, we had the situation that drivers had to hand over the cars, quite similar as today in the teams. There's one number one driver and one number two driver. And in this time, if the number one driver had a technical problem, the number two, number three, four driver had to give their car to the leading driver. And for example, that's why here at the Ferrari team, Gonzalez had to give the car to Ascari.
Exactly. So we talked about this last time that you could have multiple. Yeah, you would have multiple drivers in all senses. Yes. So you would basically change the driver in kind of mid race if something happens. So that was quite different from the current regulations. So if your car is out, then you are out as well as a driver. So there's nothing you can do about it.
Exactly, and this was not only in the Ferrari team. The same happened in Alfa, where Fagioli had to give the car to Fangio. Mm-hmm. As these have been Ascari, Fangio had been the two top players at that season.
Yeah, exactly. So we often discuss currently the team communications, right? When we had these controversies where drivers were given team orders to kind of let the leading drivers through, and we often discuss this. Oh, this was not very. Very just or very fair. Like at that time, it wasn't even a question. You know, there was a lead, and there was kind of the second man in line. And it was team orders were the norm. So in that sense, it wasn't very, it wasn't very fair by the current standards. But that was the reality, and that's how these races worked.
Exactly, and. With this, we come to the British Grand Prix, as Gunnar mentioned. This maybe have been the most interesting for the 51 season, especially also to his, let's say, historic importance, at least to Formula One, because here it was not the number one driver, Alberto Ascari, but Froilán González, who took the first win for Ferrari in an official championship race. interesting, not only for the race itself, but also because there's a quite famous quote from Enzo Ferrari after the race, who said, "I feel as I've killed my mother." Here you have to understand that before founding his own company, he had been working for Ferrari, being early in the early days a driver himself, but mostly after the team, the chef of the official Alfa Romeo racing team. There had been some frictions between him and the company, and that's why he left and founded later the Scuderia Ferrari. And said for Italians, maybe more for the British at that time, it was very emotional. So that's why he famously said, "I feel I've killed my mother." In this case, interesting, it was, I think, 3 or 4 weeks ago when there was the birthday party of Alfa Romeo in their museum, the 110th anniversary, which have been presented live in YouTube, and you still can see it there in Italian or also with English subtitles. And there, the Alfa Romeo responsible explained that the company sees themselves somehow as the mother of motorsport. So this is also a little bit their self-understanding. So it was not only Enzo Ferrari who said this, but this was also somehow an understanding in Alfa Romeo being the mother company for motorsport, as they've been successful that that early.
I guess not many people were able to attend because of COVID, but it's great that they did the broadcast. So like I said, Patrick, yeah, the Silverstone race was very important, and this was finally we saw a challenge for Alfa Romeo, and you know, it was obvious that fuel efficiency would become one of the interesting advantages, competitive advantages in the sport. And yeah, so from that point on, I guess Ferrari became a real competitor in Formula One competition and in other racing competitions, in fact. And yeah, definitely this domination was due to engineering that we're going to look at right in a second as well.
Exactly. And practically, this first win Silverstone had been the start of a series of 3 wins in a row. After Silverstone, we are going to Germany, which also was important for the country because it has been banned for international sports competition until 1951. So now it was the first Formula One Grand Prix after the Second World War. It was held at the Nürburgring. The classic Nordschleife, also known as the Green Hill, and I think someday we will do a special just on this traditional racetrack. It is quite near to Spa-Francorchamps, so also here I had once the pleasure to drive with a normal car over this racetrack, and even, let's say, if you're going with a Volkswagen Golf, it's quite impressing how this racetrack is. So you may imagine driving it in a Formula One or any other kind of sports car.
Definitely. I mean, for me, the highlight of my my visits to Nürburgring was when I saw, basically there was Quentin Tarantino attending a race, and he was sitting like just a few rows away from me, and I remember the entire yeah, that's basically entire sector stood up when he appeared and thought, oh, you know, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Even though he didn't have anything to do with racing.
Yeah, I mean, he never even did any movie related to racing.
Well, I mean, you could argue that there is a lot of cool driving in his
okay.
Films, right? And definitely, right. He's a fan of some of the fantastic driving movies as well. So. So in a sense, yeah, I mean, there is not much, he didn't do any racing himself, but yeah, definitely he shot a lot of action with cars that is very difficult to do because I think he did it all analog. It's not digital. It's not CGI. So yeah, in his films, it's all real people driving, and some of that is very, very difficult to do. So we can talk about it at one point, maybe discuss some films, some of our favorite films. But Tarantino is a fan of a film called Vanishing Point, for example, and that's kind of American driving movie, which is very, very famous.
Yeah, so maybe we do one episode about movies. Yeah. By the way, Nürburgring, maybe it's one of the courses which is most difficult for the drivers. And this time it was won by Alberto Ascari, so it was his first victory in championship. And he also could repeat the success, very important for him as an Italian driver, in the next weekend at Monza, so which was the third victory for Ferrari in a row.
Mm-hmm.
Also quite interesting and a little bit in opposite to the last years. Today, the championship had been open until the last race, which has been held in Spain. So practically, they both could still win, Fangio and Ascari, but due to the better luck in this case, it was Fangio who could win the race, even if the pole position was able to reach Alberto Ascari, but he had technical problems in the race.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And so it's just Alphas were faster, but it was already obvious that the fuel efficiency, will be a real serious contender. Yeah.
Exactly. And with all these different results, as we already said, it was the first championship for Juan Manuel Fangio. And I don't know, you want to we go now to see a little bit the cars?
Yeah, we should see the cars, definitely.
Yes. So let's start with the winning car. We have last year, the Alfetta, meaning the little Alfa Romeo. It was an evolution model. So you see on the right, the 159 as used 51, and in the background you see the elder 9050 mm-hmm. version. The differences have been mostly the two little wings mm-hmm. after the front tires, but more or less it was the same car which already Alfa Romeo started to develop in 1937.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was kind of this season it was obvious that it's kind of coming to an end, this domination of this car, yeah.
Yes, even if it's still, if you look at it, I mean, from the outside, the car still looked very competitive.
It's still beautiful. It looks great today.
Yes, it still looks great today. As we said, the last time we both saw this car in person, and the cars, the photos here I took at the Alfa Romeo Museum, they have two 159. One in the normal exposition, and the other one is in their vault, in their secret chambers, as you may call them. So you they're not that secret. You can see also this part of the museum, but you would have to call them first and
book in advance.
Exactly, yeah. Book in advance. And also important, the other one is the model by Fancho. So you see the yellow and the blue of his car, and around twice a year they still drive these cars. So it's important that these are not cars only in a museum, but Alfa Romeo also keep them in maintenance and drive them from time to time. So they give them to some Formula One drivers. The last time it was driven by Kimi Raikkonen. Before this, I think the Spanish testing driver for Ferrari, Marc Genet, drove this car. So they still are in a relatively good shape and you can drive them today.
Yeah, definitely. You probably could race in these cars if you wanted to.
Yes, I don't know if they include the 159, but Alfa Romeo has like a small department who prepare the cars for classic car races. Mm-hmm. With this, you're coming to the Ferrari 375 as it was used in the beginning at the end of the season. As earlier, they used the 275 and still the 100, the earlier model. But this was the 375, which also produced the first victory.
And you can see the difference, right, between Alfa Romeo and Ferrari. You can... In previous season, they were kind of all looking very, very similar. I mean, here you can appreciate how different that looks. I mean, even though they're both red and the fourth, they're both similar shape, you can see the difference between the two cars.
Exactly. They look quite different and interesting, but this was something general at that time. I mean, look, the drivers, I mean, they have their polo shirt, they have open helmet, I mean, no safety suit or whatever. So you can imagine any kind of accidents had been quite more severe results than today, because the drivers nearly wore no protections. And besides this, the car itself had not been designed for protection. I mean, you see the helmet is over the car, so if there would be an accident, the car could not protect its driver.
Yeah, exactly. And a part of the reason why we didn't have suits and everything else was the weight, right? We're going to discuss that at a later point, I guess. But yeah, there was for many years in Formula One, the kind of lighter drivers had an advantage over slightly heavier people.
Right.
One of the ways to make the car go fast is to have to be quite light, as you can possibly be. And
today the weight is not the problem, but nevertheless, if there would be a very tall driver, yes, it's still the problem, because you couldn't design the car so aerodynamically that also a taller driver would fit. So
yeah, exactly. So yeah, there were many considerations here, but yeah, I mean, one of the reasons why the original cars were so kind of, you know, you were completely exposed was, you know, precisely for that reason, that you couldn't add too much weight. And we discussed, and we will discuss color in one of the episodes. And, you know, color adds a lot of weight as well when you need to paint the car. But clearly, like, everything that you are wearing also adds the weight. And, you know, for many years, it was, the team decided was the good idea to have as a uniform was kind of the standard. But yeah, but then it became, you know, quite so, how currently it's heavily regulated, like what you should be wearing, what type of protection you should be wearing.
Yeah. Exactly. And interesting point at the end, even if this was the first car who gave Ferrari a victory in an official Formula One race, they do. I think they do not have it for their museum. So I don't know where you can see this car today, in if it's in a museum or in somebody has it privately. At least they don't have it in the official Ferrari museum. Formula One, they are a little bit limited as due to their successful history, they practically only show the Formula One cars which won the championship and not single races. Okay, then we come to a French team.
Yeah, Simca Gordini. That's again, that's a drawing because I couldn't find any pictures and in public domain of Simca Gordini.
So you draw it or who?
But you can actually find, if you Google it, you will find the T15, which was the 1951 season car. Yeah, and you can see that kind of tries to mimic, well, at least in my amateur view, it probably tries to mimic the Alfa Romeo. It's very, yes, very similar to that. So it's quite distinct from Ferrari. So Simca Gordini car. Yep. Talbo Lago. Well, Talbo at that time. T26C DA. So this one, you can actually see that in if you go to historical kind of races, you can see quite a few of these cars. I do not know. I think it's a little bit like a hybrid in terms of what it looks like between Ferrari and Alfa Romeo.
Yeah, you're right.
But I think it's just also a very interesting piece of engineering. To me, looks quite distinct from the rest. So, you know, it's not. You can really see the difference between the previous season with these cars. I don't know if we have any American cars in the presentation, but we have Maserati. Oh yeah, Maserati again. Look at that. Again doesn't look like Alfa anymore. So if last season we showed the previous version, and that was quite a quite similar to Alfa. Yeah, and what is interesting about this is also the color. So this is where we started to get colors kind of specializations by country, and you can see that the Italian cars are mostly in red.
Yes.
French cars are mostly in blue, and we also had British cars mostly in green. So again, we will do a separate episode on color, which is very interesting. But
and starting with the 52 we will also see then more of the British teams, so we get some more green then.
Exactly. But like I said, the main difference, I guess, in engineering we saw with Ferrari, the Ferrari engines, right? And that's a 4.5 liter engine, whereas the rest are smaller and less fuel efficient.
Agreed with you. And with this, we're coming again to the people.
Yeah.
To the drivers.
Yeah, and Patrick was talking about the young driver Fangio, but as you can see, he was 40. He was young in the sense that he was new to the sport, he was experienced guy in racing, right?
Yeah, and we will see this, I guess, in another episode.
And we've talked about Nico Farina last time, so he was also not very young when he was competing. Here you can see that Gonzalez was the youngest of these three that you see on the screen, definitely. But as you can see, most of them were kind of like 30 and up, right?
Interesting, in the last year when we spoke about 1950, we spoke about the gentleman driver. We will speak also about this in a special Fangio episode. in opposite to last year's winner, Farina, he had not a background of a rich family, but he started being a mechanic and entered that way the sports. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't the gentleman driver, as it was still quite common in these days.
Yeah, exactly. And we just want to remind the viewers that the majority of these guys knew quite a bit about cars, and you know, they could probably fix the car if they needed to do it, because you know, it was not so narrowly specialized as now. So you actually have I'm not saying that contemporary drivers cannot fix the car; they probably can, but there are special people for that we have on teams. But I mean, these guys could, you know, actually sometimes had to do it, and they definitely knew mechanical engineering quite well, and you know, they all had the training from early age, probably not so early as the current drivers, but you know, they were not so concentrated on driving. They were basically car enthusiasts and then
exactly.
Became drivers. Yeah.
Exactly, but let's say this is also similar as for us with our private cars. I mean, maybe our fathers, mothers, they could still work on the car, but if there's now any kind of problem, you go to the dealership and they connect the car to the computer to tell them what is wrong.
Yeah, and that really gets me. I think you know, we're losing the kind of this ability to fix things ourselves. A lot of things get thrown as a result. So yeah, I think I would like to promote people fixing things themselves,
yes.
Or at least trying to make sense of the engineering, of the car engineering, and trying to fix things, you know, when they can. But yeah, that happens. That is not commonplace anymore. Yeah, now we have other people who do it for us, which is unfortunate in my view. It is great to see that, of course, in large teams, and how, you know, people work as a team. So it's kind of the maverick of the teamwork that we can observe. But yeah, in private life, that is, I think, quite sad that we're losing the ability to fix our own cars.
Yeah, so Juan Manuel Fangio, we will speak in a separate episode. I assume also about Alberto Ascari, as he will win later championships. Mm-hmm. Jose Froilán González, he never won any championship, even if he was a talented driver. So he's a little bit in the shadow as the big names, as Fangio or Ascari. Quite interesting when you see him on the photos, even if he was sport. He did, of course, sports, but I mean, he looks always a little bit chubby on the photos. That's why he was also called the bull from the Pampa.
Mm-hmm.
But he was a very talented driver, and he not only drove Formula One for Ferrari, but also the sports cars. And he was a good friend of Fangio.
Yeah, and let's not forget that he won the first race for Ferrari.
Exactly, and that's
so
why
that's the guy who made it happen.
Exactly, and that's why all Ferrari fans will, of course, remember his name, even if he never won a championship. He's, of course, an important driver for the history of the company. And I will come back to this in one of the later slides, because he was not such a big name as Fangio. He does not have his own museum, but he has a whole level in the Juan Manuel Fangio Museum, which you can see near Buenos Aires, if you are ever there.
Mm-hmm.
So interesting, 1950, we had two successful Argentinian drivers, which was maybe not only a coincidence, because as it was common, especially in less democratic countries before the Second World War or also still now, the rulers like to present the superior of the system with technology. I mean, you see this not only in racing. You saw the race to the moon between Russia and the United States. So technology had been always used as an example of the superiority of a political system. And in this time, Perón, the president of Argentina, liked the example seen in Europe and also heavily promoted motorsports. There had been important races in Argentina at that time, and we mentioned it the last time because there was unfortunately this bigger accident with Farina. But also they supported young talent, as for example Juan Manuel Fangio. So they supported his career with supporting the budget, making him able to drive at local races, but also to go to Europe. And quite interesting, even if Perón and Evita had been more on the left side, they privately also liked European sports car. For example, Perón had a Ferrari 212 Inter Gia Coupé, and his wife Evita owned a 1950 Maserati. So they all also privately liked Italian sports cars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we will talk about Fangio separately, but Fangio, yeah, he was basically, he came from a large family. He was a fourth child in an immigrant family. And yeah, his grandfather came from Italy, and yeah, so it was not an easy living. But yeah, he was. I think also we have to thank his parents who actually made it possible for him. So they actually supported him in his desire to become a mechanic first, and then a driver. So that made a huge difference. So yeah, if you want your kids to excel in this, I guess you need to offer them support.
Yeah, that's like today or back in these days, it helped a lot. And as shortly mentioned, there is the official museum. If you're going to Buenos Aires, I think you can do a day trip to this little town, which is Alcácer, if I'm not completely wrong. And it's famous for being the hometown of José Manuel Fangio. For this, they have
He was born there.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he was born there, lived there. And so for this, they have the museum. And I've mentioned one level is dedicated to Fräulein González, as he doesn't have, unfortunately, his own museum.
Yeah.
But also González, I mean, he was also from the province of Buenos Aires, so not that far away from the capital.
Yeah. So the two, like Patrick said, two drivers in 1951 season from Argentina.
Exactly. I had to pleasure to be several times in Argentina, but to be honest, I never have been in this place.
So next time when we can fly finally.
Yes, also because of the COVID, the museum is closed at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully there are some virtual tours. There is a virtual visit I can see on the page there, but yeah, hopefully there are some virtual tours people can take.
Exactly, and with this I come over to one similar ideas. I mean, as you saw in the last time, as you may see also in the next years, it's interesting to learn about this cars, the drivers, and I hope we can start also you with this little YouTube channel to make you more interested if you want to dig a little bit deeper. You see sometimes historical videos in other YouTube channels Of course, always a highlight is to visit the regarding museums.
Read books.
Read books, yeah, of course.
Read books.
Read books. But nevertheless, even the best book, I mean, it's not comparison to see the cars in the museums. And luckily, all the big manufacturers, they have the very beautiful car museums. For example, Alfa, as seen here, Ferrari, but also Mercedes-Benz, BMW. And luckily, you find a lot of small museums dedicated to the drivers, as I would assume this Juan Fangio Museum in Argentina, or there's a small museum outside from Montreal about Gilles Villeneuve. So it's always great to see this museums, and really it helps you to inspire, because you can experience the cars with all your five senses. I mean, you see them, you can smell maybe them, the motor, the leather. If you're lucky, you can hear the engine. Sometimes you may taste or touch, not that often. So it's really an important source for inspiration. And quite interesting was a study by Daisy van Kort and Andrew Steptoe, which I found last year, which concludes if you are regularly visiting museums, so independent which type, this seems to have a positive correlation to your health, as people who often frequent museums are healthier than people who don't. So something you may think about.
Yeah, definitely. But you know, in general, I think it makes sense to not only listen to podcasts and watch YouTube videos, but also to read and try to find information from other sources. And yeah, like Patrick said, there are also quite a few very interesting films that are coming out about Formula One. There were quite a few of movies, so I guess we could maybe do a separate episode where I could tell you about my favorite films.
And there were, yes, both, and maybe we have to do a list first to see if some of them are in Amazon or in Netflix as homework.
Yeah.
And by the way, there's one interesting a documentary about Juan Manuel Fangio on Netflix, which I think is a Netflix original, so it should be available wherever you are listening to us.
Yeah,
definitely. And to finish my very few ideas on museums, as a lot of them had been closed or are still partly closed, it's interesting how they include maybe virtual exhibits. Some, as for example, the Ferrari Museum, they use the internet to extend the experience, so you can participate in quiz about the museum, so you can go there after you visit the museum or as preparation before you go there. Because one of these problems when we speak about motorsports is that these places are all over the world, so it's not a place where you go frequently, normally, if you're not living there. So mm-hmm. It will be interesting for museums, I think, to extend their services. I mean, a virtual exhibition can never replace the real visit, because you cannot experience even with the artificial reality, you cannot experience it with five senses, so it will never replace it, but it can extend it, and this will be something that museums may think about in the future. Something which I may back later, there's one interesting app on the iPhone, maybe also on Android, where you can, if you have virtual reality glasses, you can walk to the Michael Schumacher collection and see his different cars. So this is one example where one museum already offers a real virtual tour and not only show a slideshow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely, definitely. So yeah, by all means, check out local museums, even if you don't have a big, collection devoted to a particular team, you will have some cars from, maybe a few years, and definitely that's worth looking into and maybe reading and checking out the virtual exhibits in the current conditions when we cannot maybe visit museums. Yeah, so I think we discussed quite a lot the behavior. Yeah, like I said, to me this season was particularly important in terms of behavioral differentiation and strategy differentiation. Like I gave you an example before of the Switzerland race. I mean, this one of course is Silverstone. This is one of the one of the circuits that I'm familiar very, very familiar with. It was quite, you could already differentiate between strategies, the decisions about tires, the decisions about weather, the decisions about, when do you do pit stops, were starting to be very important. And, this differentiation then, already in 1951 season, but then in later seasons, we will see how the importance of these decisions grows with, higher speeds and better driving. Notable win for me, I don't know how about you, Patrick, but that's definitely, Silverstone win for Ferrari.
I agree there with you, yes.
Yeah, I think that's probably the highlight of the season. Notable accidents, actually, I don't have any... anything to say there. I mean, to me, I just wanted to highlight how difficult it was to race in the rain, and particularly in Swiss season, was Swiss Grand Prix was quite a challenging one. I think there were a lot of mechanical faults, in terms of actual accidents. I can't really have a highlight. It's not like in the previous season we had like 9 cars in the same accident. So to me there was probably no notable accidents, but generally we could highlight the difficulty of driving in the rain. And the notable strategies for me would be the tire decisions that became kind of very important this season, and generally I think the behavior that we observed in 1951 started to be very weighted in terms of you would consider the engineering of the car, because there was considerable heterogeneity now in the makes and in the performance. The weather and the kind of the game theory around you, what your competitors doing, like what is your relative standing. And we saw that, that you could be on the pole but still not win the race for technical reasons and for mechanical reasons. But, nevertheless, you had an opportunity to adjust your strategy to this constantly moving conditions. And that's something that, that's again where 1951 season was different from 1950, when we had a complete domination of Alfa Romeos over other teams. And in this season it was very intriguing, because we had at one point 3 wins for Alphas and 3 wins for Ferraris, and we didn't know where it's gonna go, and whoever was better in terms of strategy, this combination of strategy and character and skill, would actually be the winner.
I agree. So as you already did a very good resume, so just I like to add that, of course, I agree that the notable win was the one from Gonzalez, from a pure emotional point of view, as it's the very first official F1 victory for Ferrari, but also, let's say, if I take the emotion apart, it was the first win of a series of three wins. So it was practically not only the beginning of becoming Ferrari as the dominant team at that time, but also showed a little bit the end of the dominant of the Alfa Romeo, which had been started to be developed back in 1937. So I had a very long career, even if there was, of course, the big break because of the Second World War. And also, we saw as Formula One season, which has been quite limited based to the limited budget of the teams. We still saw a lot of teams outside not participating of the big companies. This led to the consequences that the next 2 years there would be a Formula One season, but based on Formula Two requirements as to reduce the budget. And this also meant practically the end of the Alfetta, because Alfa Romeo, as it was already owned by the government at that time, if I'm not completely wrong, hadn't a car for Formula 2 requirements, in opposite to Ferrari, which had already a Formula 2 car, the 166. And also Alfa Romeo hadn't had the budget to invest into such a car. And that's why Alfa Romeo decided to leave the championship, which of course opened the way also for Ferrari to win the next championship, because there have been practically no strong opponents left.
Yeah, also, but then we had McLaren a few years later.
That's right. I'm just speaking about 52.
Yeah. Appreciate
and
that. Yeah.
I think this is already one of the important points we will discuss then the next time, because we see slowly the rise of the British teams.
Yeah, and British motorsport, exactly. which was kind of, yeah. So then we had, even strong Italians, strong French, strong Americans, strong Brits. So it was very interesting. Yeah, definitely. And so we are going to definitely talk about this. Yeah. So, in terms of legacy, yeah, for me, this was the rise of the Ferrari. the rise of Team Ferrari, how I would characterize this season. I don't know whether, I mean, Patrick always has some cool quotes, so he probably...
I don't have a quote. As I said, I already mentioned this quote, I feel that I killed my mother, which... showed the importance of this win for Enzo Ferrari, as on the one hand it was he celebrated it, he enjoyed it, but also he felt a little bit guilty, as the Massa, especially in Italian culture, is very important. So I don't have really a good sentences, but as I've mentioned earlier, it was somehow also an Argentinian year with
the Argentinian year,
Sancho, but also with the important participation of Gonzalez.
Mm-hmm. So on that happy note, we're gonna leave you with 1951, and please do check out museums and have a read. And thanks a lot, Patrick, and we'll see you next time.
See you next time. If you like it, please like the video.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye.